We begin with the bipartisan dinner at the White House, leading to an apparent deal and confusion.
A lot of conservatives don't like it, but he cut a bipartisan deal, maybe to protect dreamers.
This is good. This is the way you get things done. And so I think a lot of folks who are in the middle, independent, maybe even moderate Democrats, probably have to be encouraged by this.
And then he went bipartisan, brought in the Democrats, got some help on tax cuts, and I think his political standing went up some more.
Good morning and welcome back to AM Joy. Many reporters and pundits got positively giddy this week about the possibility that Donald J. Trump had turned over a new bipartisan leaf. But this morning, it seems that ship has sailed. We woke up to a storm of Trump tweets and retweets because, you know, old habits die hard. There was this apparent reference to North Korean leader Kim Jong-un and his most recent missile test, although Rocket Man is a classic Elton John song. There was also this tweeted electoral map prediction. Now remember, he really likes electoral maps. He hung the 2016 one in the West Wing. He also retweeted this fan fiction video of Trump hitting what seems to be Hillary Clinton with a golf ball. Watch that drive. And of course, there's so much more that he covered in 140 characters or less, from, quote, loser terrorists to political correctness. And he's probably not done for the day because this is 2017 and Trump is president. And no amount of Chinese food with Chuck and Nancy is going to change that. And joining me now is Republican strategist Christopher Metzler, Democratic strategist Jamal Simmons, Jason Johnson, politics editor at TheRoot.com, NBC senior media editor Claire Atkinson, and Eric Bollert, senior writer at ShareBlue. And before we get into it, I want to show you guys that we, in a sense, on the set here look like a 60s singing group. These are my doo-wop men. We're working on a little number that maybe we will grace you with later. So, but I just had to show you guys that this is a complete coincidence. And when they all filed in, we just had to note that. Okay, so now let's move on to serious things.
She called us her Pips earlier.
Yeah. I said I was Gladys Knight. I might have said I was Gladys Knight. Hello, Gladys Knight and the Pips fans. All right, so, Chris, you are our Republican strategist, so I'm going to have to get you to explain. Donald Trump is up early in the morning retweeting and tweeting out memes and GIFs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Do Republicans at this point just tune it out? Do they just not care anymore?
Yeah, I think Republicans, in fact, do tune it out. They don't actually care. The problem is for Republicans, it starts to make us look like, oh, I don't know, a band of idiots. So from that standpoint, look, he's the president of the United States. He's about to address the UN.
Yeah.
And he is behaving as a two-year-old child on Ritalin.
Yeah.
I mean, this is absolutely ridiculous.
And he's calm.
I think he's not on the Ritalin.
They're
calm.
Yeah. Right. I mean, he's tweeting out Rocket Man, you know, calling the leader of North Korea, who, you know, is somebody who is incredibly erratic himself, right? Sort of belittling him as Rocket Man this morning. This golf gif of him hitting Hillary Clinton, hitting a woman with a golf ball and making her stumble. This is very strange behavior for somebody who then is going to turn around and have to give a very sober, serious speech. So why then do I ask you, did you have this week, why is it so reflexive for so many in media to say bipartisan Trump is real and to ignore this Trump?
Well, it's clear that there is no real Trump except for the one that is reactionary, that is catering to his own ego, is catering to this very small part of the American populace. And I think what we're seeing is him flailing because of this Chuck and Nancy deal that he was cutting on DACA. People are so upset with him. We saw people burning Make America Great hats this week. And I think now you see Donald Trump trying to do something to try to signal to his population, I'm still one of you. I'm still one of you.
Yeah.
Please don't leave me.
Yeah. And Jason, you know, should Democrats trust that deal? I mean, on the Democratic side of the ledger, you also had a lot of people saying, great, Chuck and Nancy are heroic. You know, some people are they calling her, they have a name for them, Chancy or
Brangelina or something.
Like that. So, I mean, is that something that Democrats should actually be cheering, the fact that, hey, whatever it took, they did get a deal?
Look, you can cut a deal with a thief whenever you
Shalosi
want.
Shalosi is the other
right, yeah, Shalosi. Yeah. You can cut a deal with a thief. You can, you know, come up with some good medicine from a drug dealer if you want to. I mean, whatever deals you got to cut, cut, you got to cut those deals.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone in the Democratic Party is stupid enough to actually believe that you can trust Donald Trump, that you actually think that he's going to be consistent. The man changes his mind depending on the last thing he saw on television or who's the last person who left the room with him.
Yeah.
I think the bigger issue is this. What issues do you want to work with him on, and how consistent can you be about it? And here's the other thing I noticed about yesterday. You know, so you have people coming out and protesting Donald Trump. He sold us out. I don't care about any of that because they're still going to vote for him.
Yeah,
and they're
right.
still going to vote for anybody who supports him.
But they burned their own $40 hats, and they're just going to buy more when he makes them out.
Exactly. Exactly.
Well, and by the way, he is selling $40 USA hats
yes.
on television while he's at disaster
yes.
relief.
And that does not offend me. We just had Katie Turner on in the last hour, and she made the point. None of it matters. Nothing matters. Literally nothing matters. Claire, I have to go to you. And first of all, welcome to the family. We know that you are now senior media editor here at NBC, so welcome to the family. I have to ask you about this because, thank you. There does seem to be a tick. That the media does have. And, you know, we can kick off your media criticism sort of thing here at NBC with this. I want to read you some headlines from the New York Times, the LA Times, and USA Today on Donald Trump's sort of bipartisanship. Energized Trump sees bipartisan path, at least for now. Week two of Donald the bipartisan. Cries of betrayal from some on the right. Trump, Pelosi, and Schumer. Bipartisanship is back at the White House. And you even had a New York Times article on September 9th that literally says that label Trump an independent, bound to no party. Trump upends 150 years of two-party rule. He's still trying to gut and dismantle Obamacare. His Justice Department is dismantling everything to do with policing reform and still trying to mass deport people. Why does the media so quickly fall for this idea that he's some sort of bipartisan deal maker?
Well, Joy, I think if you could describe the media's coverage of Donald Trump since he took office, it might be described as the Edward Munch picture of the scream. Every single day, there's outrage, outrage, outrage. And now we're in the middle of September, the United Nations speech will come. And I think the press maybe just needs a new story because perhaps everybody's just worn out of the same kind of daily outrage. And, you know, there's a new narrative required. These deals give the media an opportunity to kind of see a new twist in the story. But I mean, this whole week has been amazing. You've seen right-wing press kind of just go at Trump, particularly Breitbart with its kind of nightmare headline on the DACA story, its description of how John Kelly won't let anybody in the room with news clips during the day. He gets his briefing in the morning. He gets to see a very specific type of story. And, you know, in the week since Steve Bannon was on 60 Minutes and Kelly has come in, I think we've seen almost a different President Trump. Obviously, he is a shapeshifter and does unpredictable things all the time. But I wonder if a part of the change is due to a change in his own media diet.
I don't know that's happening. Eric Bollard, if the Clinton rules are that anything Hillary Clinton does is by definition suspect and you have to come at it from the point of view right. that she probably did committed a crime and then you work backwards from there,
yeah.
then the Trump rules seem to be if he reads the prompter, he has changed and is presidential. Right? Is that a media desire for normalcy? Or is it something particular about this particular president?
It's something about this particular president because he's a Republican white man. And the D.C. press is enthralled of Republican hardball. Look, I guarantee you what happened this morning was that Trump finally saw some of the taped interviews Hillary Clinton gave last week, particularly the interview with Rachel Maddow, where she eviscerated Trump in detail at length. There's no way Trump was going to see Hillary Clinton interviews and not post some sort of physical violence against her like he did this morning. But in terms of the press, there's this desire to normalize him. They're very nervous and anxious about calling him a pathological liar, calling him a sociopath, even though after 8 months, there's no debate that he is both. You talk about a pivot. Every sentence he said last week about the Republican tax plan was a lie. Every single public utterance was a lie. And we're getting these descriptions about how he's presidential. You can't be presidential if you don't know anything, if you don't know how taxes work, if you don't know how immigration works, if you don't know still how DACA and health care work. So it's impossible to do a pivot. It's impossible to be presidential. But the press is very cautious, and they don't want to call him out. He's proud of who he is. Describe who he is. He's a pathological liar.
Yeah, go on.
Well, here's the thing. Like, I understand the press reaction. Trump is like a bad prom date. Like, you're stuck with him. We're stuck with him for the next couple of years. So people are going to try to justify and make it good. Well, he didn't open the door, but he kind of paid for dinner before he flirted with the waitress and that sort of thing. And so every time he does something that's not horrible, people are rushing to try and say it's okay, because dealing with the daily reality that this man is a danger to this planet, right, not to mention everybody in this particular country, is more than most people want to write about. But that's the reality of it.
This whole conversation about bipartisanship, to me, is a ridiculous conversation. This is a conversation about opportunism. That's the question. Mm-hmm. And so for the media to sit here and say, oh, he's bipartisan. No, he's not bipartisan. He is Trump partisan.
Right, right.
That's
right.
It.
Yeah, he's not bipartisan. He's not bicurious. He's nothing. He only cares. I mean, he might be. I don't know. He only cares about what he can look good at.
Oh, this says something else about us, too, because I do believe that we saw a poll this week that we helped release from Gen Forward at University of Chicago, and they talked about education. And when people judge their own education schools, they'll say, oh, my school is about an A or a B.
Right.
They judge schools at large, they say, oh, schools at large are C's and D's.
Right.
Right. If we say that something's wrong with Trump, maybe there's something wrong with us.
Yeah.
And I think there's something in that, that maybe there's something wrong with us if we fully acknowledge how bad this man is and how unqualified he is to be president.
I think it's important. And Claire, you know, when I spoke with Katie about her book, she writes a lot about the people who were at Trump rallies who looked like perfectly nice people, but who had on some of the most vile, vulgar, you know, shirts that they were putting on their bodies with the C word, mm-hmm. Women putting that on their bodies, a man with his wife and children wearing the C word emblazoned across the shirt. And the question, though, is the media so wedded to this veneration of the voter that we actually just don't feel comfortable even judging, as, you know, to Jamal's point, that maybe there are people who maybe are a little bit deplorable, and that is such a hard thing for the media to ever admit, because everyone's good. All the voters are good. All the voters are virtuous. Is that part of what this is? Media not wanting to insult any voters that voted for Donald Trump?
I don't know. I think there's been plenty of insults in the media on both sides. But I do think it's interesting to see Breitbart and Ann Coulter and Sean Hannity and lots of very pro-Trump people and outlets now suddenly having a lot of criticism of what he's been doing this week. And I think there's going to be, if it continues, then perhaps there'll be this change of who's on the left and who's on the right and who's criticizing Donald Trump and who's supporting him. I think we'll perhaps see that change if these policy decisions continue to be unpredictable and continue to perhaps, if Trump continues to work with the Democrats, we'll see some surprising changes in how the media covers him.
Do you think so, Eric? Do you see that happening?
Well, I don't think Trump is going to continue to advance the Democratic agenda ad nauseum for the rest of the year. I mean, I think, you know, the tweets this morning show he'll go
well, the
back
rest of the day.
You know, he'll go right back to what he did. But look, you know, to your point, Joy, about the press and the voters, not only doesn't the press want to call voters out, they want to, you know, hold them up as kind of virtuous. I mean, how many New York Times stories have we read about these, you know, white Rust Belt voters? I mean, they've written at least 15 profiles since January. Yeah. And never once do they ask, hey, isn't Trump racist, and why did you vote for a racist? It's all this softball stuff. So not only are they not asking questions, they're kind of, you know, whitewashing this stuff in a very dangerous way.
Yeah, Getty Images is probably sold out of working class white men stares longingly out window. That photo is sold out. You can't buy anymore. I guess we'll all be back. And up next...